Blackstone presents The Gryphon's Skull by Harry Turtledove. This book is read by Tim Campbell. Dedication. The Gryphon's Skull is dedicated to Jack Horner, whose dinosaur lives gave me the idea for it. I owe him special thanks for the pleasure of his conversation and for his patience with my questions about Protoceratops skulls. Any errors, of course, are purely my own. A note on weights, measures, and money. I have, as best I could, used in this novel the weights, measures, and coinages my characters would have used and encountered in their journey. Here are some approximate equivalents. Precise values would have varied from city to city, further complicating things. 1 digit equals 3/4 of an inch. 4 digits equals 1 palm. 6 palms equals 1 cubit. 1 cubit equals 1.5 feet. 1 plethron equals 100 feet. 1 stadion equals 600 feet. 12 kalki equals 1 obolos. 6 oboli equals 1 drachma. 100 drachme equals 1 minna, about 1 pound. 60 minne equals 1 talent. As noted, these are all approximate. As a measure of how widely they could vary, the talent in Athens was about 57 pounds, while that of Aegina, less than 30 miles away, was about 83 pounds. 1. Spring. Never in all his 26 years had Menedemos been so glad to see the sailing season come round again. Not the winter in Rhodes was harsh. Menedemos had never seen snow fall here, nor had his father. Even so, his fingers caressed the steering oar tillers of the merchant galley Aphrodite as they might have stroked a lover's skin. His cousin Sostratos stood on the Akatos' poop deck with him. Sostratos was a few months older and most of a head taller, but Menedemos captained the ship. His cousin served as Tikarkos, keeping track of the Aphrodite and of what they would bring in and spend on their trading run. Sostratos had a splendid head for numbers. People gave him a good deal more trouble. From the quay at which the Aphrodite was tied up, Menedemos' father called, "Be careful, by the gods, be extra careful." "I will, father," Menedemos said dutifully. One of the reasons he was so glad to escape Rhodes was that that meant escaping Philodemus. Living in the same house with him through the winter had been harder this year than in any other Menedemos could remember. His father had long been convinced he couldn't do anything right. As if to prove as much, Philodemus called, "Listen to your cousin. Sostratos has the beginnings of good sense." Menedemos dipped his head, as Hellenes did to show assent. He shot Sostratos a hooded glance. Sostratos had the decency to look embarrassed at such praise from the older generation. Sostratos's father, Lysistratos, stood alongside Philodemus. He was a good deal more easygoing than his older brother. But he too said, "You're going to have to watch yourselves every single place you go." "We will." Even Sostratos let a little exasperation show, and he got on with his father far better than Menedemos did with his. But Lysistratos persisted. "Not just pirates these days, you know. Since Ptolemaeus and Antigonos started fighting again last year, there'll be more war galleys on the sea than a dog has fleas. Some of those horsens are just pirates in bigger, faster, stronger ships." "Yes, Uncle Lysistratos," Menedemos said patiently. "But if we don't go out and trade, the family goes hungry."
"Well, that's true," Lysistratos admitted. "Watch out for the silk merchants on Kos," Philodemus warned. "They'll gouge you if you give them half a chance, even a quarter of a chance. They think they've got the world by the short hairs because you can't buy silk anywhere else."
"They have a point, too," Menedemos thought. Aloud, he said, "We'll do our best. We did all right with them last year, remember? And we've got Crimson Dye aboard. They always pay well for that." His father gave more advice. In a low voice, Sostratos said, "If we keep listening to them, we'll never get to sail." "Isn't that the truth?" Menedemos whispered back. He raised his voice to call out to the crew.
"Rowers to the benches! Diocles, come up to the stern, if you please."
"Right you are, skipper,"
Diocles answered. The Clefstis was in his early 40s, his skin tanned and leathery from endless summers at sea. He mounted from the undecked waist of the Akatos to the poop. His bare feet were sure and quiet as he came up the steps to the raised platform at the stern. Seamen didn't wear shoes aboard ship, and few of them bothered with shoes ashore.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.